So the deviation we were observing, that the deviation in the measurement of transmittance can cause the error in the measurement of concentration, and it usually happens due to the deviations like real chemical or mechanical or electrical imperfection of the instrument, or non-uniformity of our measurement, or non-linearity of the meter scale or detector. And it may also be due to the variation in the instrument. Now, we are measuring the error which is occurring while the measurement of the transmittance. Okay, so it affects the measurement of the concentration, and that is why we observe error while measuring the concentration. So you can say that it is the relative error which is occurring due to the error in the measurement of transmittance, right? So what we can say from this, that relative error, it is equal to error in measuring the concentration, and which is divided by the true value of the concentration. So we can write this relative error as RE, and it is given by this equation delta C upon C. Okay, now what is this delta C? So delta C is the relative error in the measurement of the concentration, and it is divided by the true value of the concentration C. Now similarly, the error also occurs while we perform the measurement of transmittance. Okay, so we call it as a photometric error, and it is given by PE, photometric error, delta T. P is equals to delta T, change in the transmittance from the true or original value. So there was a person named Ringbaum. He studied the relationship between relative error and photometric error. Why? Because you know, concentration is related with transmittance, or absorbance is related with concentration as per Lambert-Beer's law. So he studied the relationship in between and noted that the relationship between this percentage relative error and the transmittance error. So numerically, if you write the Ringbaum plot, if you want to define the Ringbaum plot, so before that you have to understand this, that it is the ratio of the relative error in percentage with the photometric error. So this is the definition of the Ringbaum plot. That Ringbaum plot can be defined as the one which gives us the relationship between relative error in concentration and the transmittance. So from the Beer's law, Lambert's Beer's law, what do we know? That absorbance is equals to epsilon BC, right? And absorbance is equals to minus ln T. It is the logarithmic scale. So both of this can be equated together. So I am writing this. Now we will take derivative on both sides. So after taking derivative, it will look like this. D ln T is equals to minus epsilon V. The constant will be kept out, and the operator will only see the changing, the variable one. So it is the delta C. So D ln T can be written as delta T upon this is with respect to transmittance. So D ln T can be written as delta T upon T is equals to minus epsilon B into delta C. So this is equation one. Now let's determine delta C. So we will keep this delta C on one side, and we will take this minus epsilon B on the other side. So delta C is equals to minus delta T upon T into 1 upon epsilon V. This will be equation number two. Now we will replace this epsilon B as we know, absorbance is equals to epsilon bc. So what will be epsilon b? Absorbance is equals to epsilon into b into c. So epsilon into b is equals to a upon c. So if you keep the value of this epsilon b over here, so it will appear like delta c is equals to minus delta t upon t multiplied by c upon a. Okay, so delta c is equals to minus delta t upon t into c upon a. Now we are interested into the relative error. So to make it a relative error, we will take this c on the other side. So this will become delta c upon c, which is equals to minus delta t upon ta. Now this delta t is nothing but it is change. So here we can neglect this negative sign. We will calculate for the general. Just a minute. Yes. Can you see this PDF? Students, can you see this PDF?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So now what you will find here that delta C upon delta T. This is delta C and we had a relative error. So delta C upon C is equals to 1 upon T into A. Now what is A here? So A is minus log T. Okay, and we had a minus sign. So we are writing it as log T. So this will be 1 upon t into log t, okay, or ln t. So 1 upon ln, what is the value of that logarithmic n function? So logarithmic function is 2.303. So if you take 1 upon 2.303, so it will become 0.433. see, okay, so that is why we will have here 0.4343 and this ln will now change to log. So, and then we will take the minus delta t, which was earlier on this side, it will be taken up here. Why? Because we are interested into the relationship between the relative and photometric error. So delta c upon delta t will be equal to 0.434 upon t log of t. So here they have shown in the direct way, but this is the simple derivation of the ring bomb plot. Now they have used this equation, delta C upon C, that is the relative error divided by the photometric error, to give you this relationship. Okay, now what they mean to say here that relative error increases at the extremes of the transmittance scale. So what will be the extreme point of this transmittance scale? So one will be here near to the zero and one will be at the higher side, somewhere here around. So for the maximum transmittance, you will get the concentration here, and for the minimum transmittance, you will get the maximum concentration here. So the slope of this plot of C, log C, it is plotted in front of C, okay, against T. So this means that when we will move toward the extreme end of the transmittance, either towards the smallest one or either towards the greatest one. So what will happen? There will be maximum relative error. Okay. So this is what they discovered from this equation. Now, you can refer this topic from page number 526 of the book Gary, Analytical Chemistry by Gary Christian. Here they have mentioned spectrometric error in measurement and they have accounted this ring bump plot here. And what they want to indicate here that, yes, let me share this graph with you. Yes, so they have shared this graph. So here they have taken delta C upon C for delta T. And on the x-axis, they have taken percentage transmittance. They have also considered the absorbance. So what they are saying that at 36.8% transmittance, there is minimum relative error with respect to delta T. That you can see from the graph. This U shape is not going below down from this point, 36% transmittance. Okay, so this is what they have mentioned here. So it is evident from the figure that minimum error occurs at 36.8% T. Nearly constant minimum error occurs. So if you see, just a minute, I'm getting a call. So yes, what else we can see from here that this y-axis of the relative error. So from range 20% to 80% transmittance, there is a constant minimum error. There is very less variation. It is minimum. But below this point 20% transmittance and above this point 80% transmittance, the value of the relative error is the highest. So the constant minimum error occurs over the range of 20 to 65% or the percentage transmittance should fall within 10 to 80% if you want to avoid the large error in spectrophotometric reading. Means for 20 to 65% transmittance, what is the value of absorbance? So it appears around 0.1 to 0.7, yes, or you can consider it for 1. So that is what they have mentioned here. For minimum error, the absorbance should fall in the 0.1 to 1 range. And also note this caption. This graph is all about the relative concentration error as a function of transmittance. Okay, for 1% uncertainty in percentage transmittance. So this is the ring bump plot, and from this last equation, what they want to conclude that delta C upon C is the relative error in concentration, which is resulting from an error in delta T in the measurement of transmittance. So three or four things we can conclude here: that relative error is very high. Yes, relative error is very high at both high and very extreme end of the transmittance percentage. So this error can also occur when you take very highly concentrated solution or very diluted sample concentration, because that will directly affect the transmittance of the light. Similarly, the relative error is found to be the lowest or minimum at 36.8% transmittance value. It is not going deeper than this. Okay, then what we can conclude else? Third point. So third point is that relative error is lowest in the region of 20 to 60% transmittance range. So for best result, what we can do to avoid this spectrophotometric error or error while performing the measurement in spectrophotometer, that we should work in 20 to 60% transmittance range, or our absorbance should not go below 0.1, or not, it should not go above 1 absorbance. Though you know maximum value for absorbance can be 2, but at that point you can face large value for relative error. So if you have taken diluted sample, then you should concentrate it by extraction or evaporation technique. And if you have taken sample with high concentration, so you should simply dilute it. So this was all about the ring bomb plot. Now, yes, so ring bomb plot is clear to everyone. The conclusion is clear.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so now we will take the derivative spectroscopy. Just a minute. Okay, so this is a simple spectra, UV spectra of caffeine. Now here you can, how many peaks you can see in the spectra?
2 peaks, ma'am.
Very good. And what about this spectra?
Only 1. No, 2.
Are you sure there are 2? Because all of you can see 2 peaks are there.
Ma'am, one is from 190 and the another one is between 262 to 286.
Okay. So let me tell you that why do you took this much of time, okay, to simply answer the number of peaks. Now in the first figure, this graph is sufficiently resolved so that you can determine the lambda max, that you can see 2 lambda max, one for this peak and the other one you can see for this peak, isn't it?
Yes.
Now this is not always the same case as in this figure. You cannot see the baseline as flat as in the first one. The two lines are overlapping to each other. They are not flat. This, you cannot say this is a peak. How can you say this is a peak? Can you see the beginning of this peak? Tell me.
No, ma'am.
No, so we cannot say this is a peak, though it may be, because you are observing from the overlapping, the two peaks are overlapping, what we can say. The baseline is not flat. Are you getting me? This peak is for caffeine. here we are also observing the peak for caffeine, but what is happening here, the sample is Pepsi Cola and this is the standard sample for caffeine. So when we are taking the standard sample for caffeine, we can see two prominent peak at 273 and 204 nanometer. The two are partially resolved. You can see the shoulder in between. But when I'm accounting the same thing in this spectrum for caffeine in Pepsi or cola drink, so these two peaks are much less prominent in comparison to the first one. And the baseline is not flat here. There is very less difference between this point and this point. Ideally, this point should be flat enough so that you can distinguish between this point and the peak. So it becomes difficult for us to say that this spectra has one or two peaks. Okay, so what we will do now? Now we will need some another method or process so that we can determine the peaks. Okay, so this practice of processing the spectrum to obtain the number of peaks, even the peak height, is known as derivative spectroscopy. So the term derivative spectroscopy, it refers to spectral measurement technique. It is a technique where or in which the slope of the spectrum, what is the slope? It is the rate of change of the absorbance with respect to wavelength, is measured as a function of the wavelength. Okay, so the first derivative spectrum we can have, when we are talking about derivative, we can have first, second, third, fourth, and up to n number of derivative. Okay, so this is the derivative spectroscopy. Now, if you recall, first semester we have studied the potentiometry or pH metry, and if you recall your physical practicals, so in potentiometry you try to find out E value, then you find out delta E, then you write down V, then you write down delta V, and finally you write delta E upon delta V. And might be some of you have seen in reference book that a third component or the third column is also determined, which is delta cube E upon delta V cube. So what are all these values? These are nothing but these are derivative of the titration curve taken from the original titration curve. So from the pilot reading, we go for the micro reading. The what is micro? Micro means is it specifies the actual equivalence point from the titration curve, whether it is in the potentiometry, whether it is in the pH metry. The similar technique we will perform here in the derivative spectroscopy. Now you may wonder that how it is useful. So we will see that, but let me tell you that we can get more information from the derivative plots of absorption observations exactly from in comparison to the original ones. So yes, now just try to have a look on the figure A. Okay, so this figure A, it is the normal absorption curve, which shows like a Gaussian distribution curve. Now, though Gaussian distribution is a part of statistics, but since we are studying here analytical chemistry, so we need to understand what is the Gaussian distribution. So Gaussian distribution in this, it has a bell-shaped curve. So if you have a look on this spectrum, it will look like a bell, curved bell, okay? And how do we determine that it is a Gaussian distribution? So if it is a Gaussian distribution, so for any measurement of value, means for any lambda max you will have normal equal number of distribution on the either side above the mean value. If say this lambda max is the mean value, so you will find equal measurements on the higher side and on the lower side of this mean value. And if you plot them all the points, so what you will get, you will get a bell shaped curve. This is known as a Gaussian distribution curve. So when we measure the absorbance of any compound, so what happens, that appears in form of Gaussian distribution curve. Okay, now yes, so A is your zero order, means it is the original spectra, it is the Gaussian distribution curve. B is your first order derivative. Okay, first order derivative means it is the derivative spectra of the Gaussian distribution curve. So if you have a look at this first order spectra, first order derivative, thus one point, it is scattered here. All the plotted points are scattered here, and the lambda max will be found at here. And first order derivative, that is dA upon d lambda, will be zero. It is at the zero with respect to the lambda max. So it becomes easy for us to find out the lambda max for any given spectra. This is the utility. Now, just a minute. Can you see this figure? Can you see this presentation?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now, might be this figure appears a bit, it is not that much clear, but what I mean to say from this figure, let me conclude that. Just follow my cursor. This is figure first A, zero order derivative. This is the original spectra. This is the Gaussian distribution curve, that for any compound M, if you plot the absorbance versus lambda plot, you will get peak over here. Now tell me, what is lambda max? Do you have any idea, do you know the lambda max? Or can you define what is lambda max or maximum wavelength? Tell me frankly, this is not your exam. आपको ये समझ में आ रहा है जो मैं पूछ रही हूँ? लैम्डा मैक्स आता है आपको? पता है इसके बारे में कुछ? अगर हाँ तो हाँ बताओ, अगर नहीं पता है तो नो बोलो. तो मुझे कुछ आइडिया है आपको?
No.
मुझे आगे क्या? यस बोलो.
नो मैम.
ओके, लैम्डा मैक्स मतलब जब हम एब्जॉर्बेंस को प्लॉट करते हैं विद रेस्पेक्ट टू वेवलेंथ. तो एक कंपाउंड को हम मान लो पहले 200 देंगे, फिर 300 का वेवलेंथ इंसिडेंट करेंगे सैंपल होल्डर पे, फिर 4, फिर 5, 6, 7, 8 अप टू विजिबल रेंज. ठीक है, तो 200 टू 800 के रेंज हम उसके ऊपर इंसिडेंट करते हैं. तो मान लो 200 पर वो कुछ एब्जॉर्प्शन शो करता है, 300 पे वो ज्यादा एब्जॉर्प्शन शो करता है. ऐसे करते करते एक पॉइंट ऐसा आएगा कि जिस पर्टिकुलर वेवलेंथ पर वो कंपाउंड ज्यादा एब्जॉर्बेंस दिखाएगा, ज्यादा लाइट एब्जॉर्ब करेगा. ठीक है, तो वो कैसे पता चलेगा? वो इसलिए पता चलेगा क्योंकि हमारा इंस्ट्रूमेंट मेजर क्या करता है, ट्रांसमिटेंस ऑफ लाइट. तो अगर लाइट का ट्रांसमिटेंस जो है वो किस तरीके से रिलेटेड है एब्जॉर्बेंस के, वो आपको पता है. ज्यादा ट्रांसमिटेंस है तो एब्जॉर्बेंस कम है, एब्जॉर्बेंस ज्यादा है तो ट्रांसमिटेंस कम है. ठीक है, तो एक हमने सपोज एक कंपाउंड लिया और उसका हमने ये स्टडी किया एब्जॉर्बेंस प्रोफाइल, ठीक है। तो एब्जॉर्बेंस प्रोफाइल में मैंने क्या देखा कि एक पर्टिकुलर वेवलेंथ पर ये मैक्सिमम एब्जॉर्बेंस शो कर रहा है। तो जिस वेवलेंथ पर कोई भी कंपाउंड मैक्सिमम एब्जॉर्बेंस शो करता है उसको बोलते हैं लैम्डा मैक्स। सो इट इज द वेवलेंथ एट विच एनी कंपाउंड शोज मैक्सिमम वैल्यू फॉर द एब्जॉर्बेंस। सो हियर इट इज एट पॉइंट एम। नाउ इट इज क्लियर टू एवरी वन व्हाट इज लैम्डा मैक्स?
यस मैम।
ओके, सो फॉर दिस जीरो ऑर्डर और गॉसियन डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन कर्व और ओरिजिनल स्पेक्ट्रा आई हैव अ वैल्यू एम। नाउ जस्ट सी द डेरिवेटिव पार्ट। First of all, I have given a first derivative spectra, that is dA upon d lambda. मैंने इसका derivatization किया absorbance का, किसके function में? ये क्या है आपका lambda के function में। तो ये जो plot था अब आप देखो तो ये पूरा spread हो गया है, so it appears in dispersed way, ठीक है। पर यहाँ पर easy क्या हो गया है कि यहाँ पर मेरा dA upon d lambda जो है वो zero होगा, तो मैं इजिली लैम्डा मैक्स इस पॉइंट पे फाइंड आउट कर लूंगी जहां पर ये दो लाइन इंटरसेक्ट कर रहे हैं, और एक पीक के लिए मुझे स्कैटर्ड या डिस्पर्स्ड प्लॉट मिलता है फर्स्ट ऑर्डर डेरिवेटिव। सिमिलरली सेकेंड ऑर्डर डेरिवेटिव देखो, डी स्क्वायर अपॉन डी लैम्डा स्क्वायर, यहाँ पर एक ही पीक के लिए मुझे एक ही पीक मिलेगी, बट दैट विल बी इन्वर्टेड, इट्स साइन विल बी इन्वर्टेड, इवन द हाइट विल बी सेम एज टू द ओरिजिनल वन। लेकिन यहाँ पर ये जो पीक है, जो मुझे इन्वर्टेड पीक दिख रही है, इट विल बी वेरी शार्प इन कंपैरिजन टू द ओरिजिनल वन। सो आई कैन चूज द एक्यूरेट लैम्डा। सिमिलरली दिस इज वन सी इज योर थर्ड डेरिवेटिव, दैट इज डी क्यूब ए अपॉन डी लैम्डा क्यूब। अगेन सिंस इट इज द ऑड ऑर्डर डेरिवेटिव, सो द प्लॉट विल बी स्कैटर्ड एंड यू विल फाइंड इट लाइक दिस। If we look at the fourth order derivative, it will appear like the even order derivative. But again, here the sign will be reversed in comparison to the prior derivative. Now, the first, second, third, and fourth order derivative plot for this original curve, you can find here that in this figure, first and third order derivative, the जो पहला row आप देख रहे हो first और third order का, so these plots have a dispersed function and they are not like the original spectra or original curve, but they can be used to fix the accurate lambda max for absorption. Similarly, in the lowest row for second and fourth order derivative, you will find the central peak which is sharper than the original band, but the peak will be of same height with the alternating signal with increasing derivative. So the advantage for even order derivative is that it is utilized for resolution. So even order derivatives, they are used to increase the resolution. It is the most useful feature of second order derivative and it helps in resolution enhancement in spectroscopic analysis. And one more thing, the magnitude of the resolution, it will depend upon the derivative order, how much which order you have utilized, and it will also depend upon the shape of the band and height of the overlapping peak. And what is the disadvantage of the even order derivative? That there will be many small peaks, satellite artifacts, we call them satellite artifacts, will appear, whose number and amplitude will increase when you will increase the order of the derivative. So there may be displacement due to the satellite artifacts then background interference can also be reduced by using this. How? So let me show you this figure. Now here I have taken a compound and it is a mixture of two substances, C and D. So initial spectra is the original spectra, like I have shown you for the caffeine. And now I am going for even order derivatization for this spectra. And I will see what does it, which kind of possibilities it offers to me. So after the second order derivatization of this zero order figure, we can see a well-defined absorption band for both the components with lambda max value. So we can differentiate the influence of the impurity on the absorption spectrum of the desired analyte or pure substance. And we can eliminate the impurity. And second order derivative will be identical with that of the pure compound. So similarly, this is the second order derivative. We can also go for nth order polynomial. And the interference here, it can be eliminated in n plus 1 derivative. Now let's take an example. Okay, can you see this figure? Can you see this figure?
Yes,
yes, yes.
Okay. Now let me tell you, this X, it is your pure compound. This Y is your impurity, but X is standard. This is the standard compound, standard pure compound I have taken. This impurity is standard impurity I have taken. This X plus Y is the mixture. This is our desired sample. Now in the sample, I am getting a peak like this when I'm plotting absorbance versus lambda. And the individual peaks are for this original spectra or zero order derivative or Gaussian distribution, it is like this. Now I'm not able to correlate this original spectra with the mixture. So what I will do, I will go for the first order derivative. The second column is for the first order derivative for the three: pure compound, impure compound and the mixture. So now for first order derivative, what I have observed that I will get the dispersed plot, but yes, d upon d lambda will pass from the zero and I will get maximum lambda max at this point. Similarly, if I go in, so from first order derivative we can determine lambda max. Then I want to perform the resolution. So I want to measure the peak height. So to measure the peak height, now I will go to the second order derivative. So in first order derivative, what I am doing, I am simply removing the background interference by first order derivative. And from the second order derivative, from the third column, you see the matrix effect is completely removed. Matrix which is arising from the impurity, it is completely removed. And you will find the peak height. It will be the actual peak height with respect to the original one. Only the sign will be different and the peak will be well resolved. The impurity will be subtracted out. We can also perform peak to height measurement. peak to height measurement is obtained using second order derivative. So d square a upon d lambda square is taken against lambda. Now you will get the two peaks here, and the derivative peak d is amplitude here, and it will appear in two form. The peak with longer length, the length is long, so this peak has a longer length, so we will name it as DL, long wave peak. Okay, then second one, this peak has short length, so we will call it as a short wavelength satellite peak. This is long wavelength satellite peak. So the two will appear, and we can sometime also consider this peak tangent. We can pass this tangent and we can name it as DB. Okay, so we can use any method to determine. Now just a minute. So this is the first derivative. You can clearly see, since d upon d lambda becomes zero, so at this point we can easily find out the lambda max for the scattered plot. Similarly, what is the relation with d upon d lambda? So it is this: a2 is for your pure compound, a1 is your impurity, lambda 2, and this is the lambda 1, difference between the two lambda. Okay, now d upon d lambda becomes 0 at the wavelength which is corresponding to the peak maxima in the original curve. Now they have given a question here: calculate the first derivative spectrum for the spectrum of potassium permanganate. They have taken delta lambda as 10 nanometer, and they are calculating this at every 10 nanometer between 420 to 630 nanometer range. So this is the zero order spectra. Now I will show you the first order. This is the first order derivative. Okay, now this is manually calculated, so you can see it. The below one, this is for the instrumental calculated first order derivative. So you can correlate. This is rough and the second one is smooth. So after smoothening, we can accurately determine the lambda max at this point. This is the second order derivative for potassium permanganate. And the second derivatization is done on the first order. So this is d square a upon dx square. Okay, so various satellite peak will emerge here, you can see. And their width can cause problem, but the peaks will be more resolved with the inverted sign of the peak. This is the second order and this is the fourth order. So we are comparing two even order derivative curve. So the peak and these peaks are increasing as we are increasing the order of the derivative. You can see their amplitude will also increase. So this is the only disadvantage, and this may also cause displacement from the center. This is the background interference, this is the impurity, and this is the pure compound, this is the total spectra. Okay, now why they are considering it like this? Because, yes, from Beer's law, what we know, that lambda means at particular wavelength the total absorbance of the system will be equal to the number of components which are present in the system. So total absorbance of the system, it is nothing but the individual sum of the absorbance shown by the components. So if we have two component, one pure and one impure, so both of them will show some absorbance at a particular wavelength lambda. So the total absorbance will be 80. Now if we take the second order derivative, so what will happen? It will look like this: d square 80 upon d lambda square equal to d square ax upon d lambda square plus d square m upon d lambda square. Now this can be written as dt is equals to dx plus dm. So from here we can remove the derivative or value of the matrix, means impurity, from the system, and we can simply focus upon the compound. So d square a upon d lambda square is equals to epsilon ECL. Okay, so here only this value will change for the second order derivative, that is the molar absorptivity. This is for the derivative spectra is used for the quantitative analysis, and since the spectrophotometry works on the principle of Lambert-Beer's law, so they are taking the derivative. So how does it appears? C and L will remain constant for any sample, but with each derivative what we are changing? The molar absorptivity function. So this I was telling to you how to determine the peak height. So this DS is the short wavelength peak satellite, DL is the long wavelength peak satellite, DB is the peak tangent baseline. We have taken the tangent to the two peaks from up top at the bottom, and we will measure this distance. We will name it as DB. Peak derivative DZ is here. This is the DZ area. Okay. So now the total derivative amplitude DT for this, it will be equal to dx plus dm. So this is all about derivative spectroscopy. Now if you have any doubt, you can ask me. And just a minute, I am downloading your attendance. Yes, so this was all about the derivative spectroscopy. Either we can measure the peak height with respect to the baseline, or we can measure it with respect to DZ, zero order peak derivative. So ring bump plot and derivative spectroscopy is now clear to you. Peak tangent or baseline method is more preferable in comparison to the derivative peak D0 method. And yes, one more thing I just forget to share you. Derivative spectra can be recorded by means of wavelength modulation devices. So we can use any device which can vary the beams of radiation in wavelengths by a small amount of 1 to 2 nanometer, or we can measure the two readings with the difference, with the different wavelength. Alternatively, what else we can have? We can have a derivative unit in our circuit, like resistance, capacitance, circuit, filter. Operational amplifiers are nowadays used. In modern technique derivative spectroscopy, we use computer-based calculations. So lastly, I hope now you can define derivative spectroscopy. It means it is a spectral measurement technique in which slope of the spectrum, that is rate of change of the absorbance with respect to wavelength, is measured as a function of wavelength. And first order derivative is a plot of spectral slope against wavelength. Second order derivative spectrum is basically derivative of first order. So we can go up to the nth order. So this was all about derivative spectroscopy. Now, if you do not have any doubt, then I hope we can end this meeting. Students, if you have a doubt, you can ask me or we can end this meeting. You are requested to leave. क्या हुआ, कुछ प्रॉब्लम है आप लोगों को? शिवानी दधानिया, आर यू देयर? हेतवी, आपको समझ आया? रिचा,
यस मैम,
आपको समझ आया डेरिवेटिव स्पेक्ट्रोस्कोपी और रिंगबम प्लॉट?
यस मैम।
ऑड ऑर्डर डेरिवेटिव को हम यूज करते हैं लैम्डा मैक्स डिफाइन करने के लिए, इवन ऑर्डर को हम यूज करते हैं रेजोल्यूशन और मैट्रिक्स रिमूव करने के लिए, रेजोल्यूशन प्रोवाइड करने के लिए और मैट्रिक्स इम्प्यूरिटी रिमूव करने के लिए। तो एटलीस्ट इतना तो आपको पता होना ही चाहिए डेरिवेटिव स्पेक्ट्रोस्कोपी के बारे में। और रिंग बॉम में तो क्या है, डायरेक्ट रिलेशन ही पूछ लेते हैं, इक्वेशन दे देंगे आपको ऑप्शन में और पूछेंगे विच इज द एक्चुअल इक्वेशन फॉर द रिंग बॉम प्लॉट। सो आई होप कि अब आप लोग इतना तो कर ही लोगे।
यस मैम।
ओके फाइन, सो नाउ यू पीपल कैन लीव दिस मीटिंग।
Okay, bye.
Bye. Bye.